What's going on, guys? This is Rob, and if you're enjoying the content here on my channel, then make sure you hit the like button and make sure you hit subscribe so you can help decide what direction the content on my channel goes in the foreseeable future.
Robcore, man, let me tell you something now, man. Injustice. Oh my god, dude, Injustice. Dude, I love Injustice so much. I can't believe I spent so long never reading these comics. What is wrong with me? Like, okay, here's the deal. If Geoff Johns' Green Lantern is anything like this, like, in terms of just how good it is, like, oh my god, it's gonna be absolutely nuts. Even my dog Max is excited about Injustice. Archie Max, yes he is, he's wagging his tail. So with this Injustice thing, remember, Superman's just kind of solidifying his new world order, right? I mean, he's solidifying his regime. And what this does is this kind of picks up with where things are right now in the sense of, you know, bad guys and capturing them and so on and so forth. What we end up finding out is that about 52% of the previously incarcerated villain base, as well as those villains that were never incarcerated, have been thrown back in jail again. And what we end up also finding out is there's a group, kind of this underground resistance group operating out of Gotham City that's invoking the name of the Joker. Now, of course, this is a dangerous game, you know, to play in the realm of Superman, because all of this in Superman's mind stems from the Joker. Honoring the man that tricked Superman into killing his wife and unborn child is an absolute no-no. And this really kind of presents an interesting quandary between those who want freedom versus those who are trying to instill oppression. But before we jump into that, we actually switch back over to Wayne Manor. And this is a beautiful moment between Alfred and Batman. I absolutely love this, because what it shows us is that Bruce Wayne just misses Alfred. I mean, Alfred's making dinner for himself, you know, and there's kind of a little bit of back and forth between the two. Alfred's been sending Batman cookies. I mean, he just misses his friend. And that's one of the greatest things about this, is because Alfred is the closest thing Bruce Wayne has ever had to a father, and he can't be there with him. Like, he can't be with Alfred. And that's what's so great about this, is Bruce Wayne's always been closed off. Bruce Wayne's always been reserved. But when you get into his heart of hearts, when you get past that thick exterior shell, what you run into is a man who's sentimental. You run into a man who's soft, a man who loves his friends and family, who cares about Alfred more than all others. And the fact that he can't be there is so crushing for him. And that's why I love it so much, is because it makes Bruce Wayne so human. Now, at this point, what we do is we kind of pick back up with Superman again. And of course, Superman is basically broadcasting out to the world, you know, individuals who are worshiping the name of the Joker, you know, people who are operating underground, you know, those people will be rooted out, those people will be found, and they will be dealt with. In addition, he's basically banning all forms of public assembly. And that's what's crazy here, because he basically says, if you're angry or you're upset that I've infringed upon this, then that's your problem. And this goes back to that argument that we made before. We basically said that people don't have a right to freedom of speech. People don't have the freedom of speech itself. The ability to speak publicly, that's a freedom, a privilege that no one ever bothered to take away before. And that's what Superman's doing. He's taking that freedom away. He's saying, look, anybody who speaks publicly will be executed. I mean, sure, I guess a dead man will have the ability to speak publicly if he were able to speak, but he's not. And the way that we end up finding Superman carrying this out is when this militant group operating, you know, under the name of the Jokers, you know, this Joker underground, when they're initially met by Batwoman, who infiltrates and says, what are you doing here? You've all virtually guaranteed your own destruction. You know, she points out Harley Quinn and says, there's no way you can be okay with this. Because remember, when word of any semblance of the Joker reached the ears of Harley Quinn, she was there. She was like, I have to know what's going on here. She investigated this before anybody else did. She's been among their ranks. She's been within them. Now, this speaks volumes, because what this means is that if these guys couldn't even figure out that the second to Joker was among their ranks, what chance do they stand against Superman? They have no hope whatsoever. And the reason why is because, like any rebel group, like any rebel faction, they're not organized. They're just a bunch of people who are running around with guns ranting about freedom and talking about how Superman's infringing on their rights. A really good example, you know, kind of sidetrack here for a second, a really good example of like an organized rebel movement came in the show Jericho. Basically what happened is there was a coup d'etat. There was a rebellion against the existing U.S. government by those who were all the way down to the ground level, normal citizens, all the way up to people at the very top in the government. And what ended up happening is they basically grabbed several nuclear bombs. They dispersed them to really like terrorist cells in the U.S. and they detonated those nuclear bombs in 23 separate United States cities. Because of that, it basically led to the complete and total collapse of the U.S. government. That's an organized rebel movement. These guys are just brothers and sisters. They're TV salesmen. They're car salesmen. They're former cops. They're all just kind of rambling about freedom, talking about how Superman infringed on their rights. They don't have a chance. And the way this comes to fruition is when Superman shows up. Initially, it's kind of like this little skirmish between Harley Quinn and Batwoman. But when word reaches the ears of Superman in terms of where this Joker underground movement is residing at, he's gone. I mean, he's off to the races. He's there in an instant. And he basically basically says, how dare you invoke the Joker's name in such a good capacity? How dare you view them in a positive light? Now, of course, Batwoman and Harley Quinn get while the getting's good. And their idea, you know, is to basically not leave them behind, but to eventually go back. Of course, Harley's kind of able to talk Batwoman into going back again. But between the time they're gone and the time they get there, Superman says, look, you guys are free to say what you want to do. You're free to ignore my ruling. You're free to speak publicly. You're free to invoke the name of the Joker. You're also free to deal with the consequences of it. And what he does is he kills every last one of them. Now, the irony of this is that people will say, well, look, they were exercising their own personal freedoms. Yes, they were. They were exercising their own personal freedoms at their own detriment. So if what they were wanting to do was go for some great, big, huge movement, if what they were wanting to do was to instill a rebellion among everybody, well, good luck, because they're all dead. And the only ones who were ever successful in freeing an occupied territory are the ones who live long enough to fight. Dead men don't solve anything. What this really does is it hits home to the heart, or hits home to the idea that Superman has basically just kind of lost his way. I mean, Superman is about as dark as he's ever been. There was a time where Superman never even would have dreamed of anything like this. And I would say, within the context of the entirety of the Injustice line of stories, this is the second worst thing that he's ever done so far. We'll see how bad he can get. He gets really, really brutal. But I'd say this is probably the second worst thing he's ever done. But transitioning to more of a lighthearted tone, we pick up with Bizarro and Trickster. Because keep in mind, when Bizarro encountered the rogues of the Flash, he killed virtually all of them because they just kind of kept making fun of him. But he killed all of them, with the exception of Glider Girl and Trickster. Of course, Trickster kind of used Bizarro to his own ends and said, hey, look, we're friends. We've always been friends. You know, me and Superman are friends. You and I can be friends, that kind of thing. And used him for his own ends. But it's also Trickster kind of becoming friends with Bizarro, really as close as a person can be with Bizarro. And it's kind of funny to see Bizarro deal with the situations that he's in, because they're talking about things like hamburger. They're talking about things like, you know, making steaks, so on and so forth. You know, and Trickster says hamburger comes from cows. Bizarro races off, grabs a cow and brings it back. You know, he says, no. We have to go to an actual restaurant. You know, we have to go to a Big Belly Burger, which has the best burgers, by the way. If you guys have ever been there, they're amazing. I highly suggest that you guys go there. But Big Belly Burger is where they end up going to. But it's kind of funny because Trickster's teaching Bizarro about what it means to be a person. He's asking him questions. Where did you come from? What's your origin story? What's the basis behind your existence? And I swear to God, if these spam contacts don't stop sending requests on Skype, I swear to God, 2017 Microsoft, surely there's a way for me to prevent people from sending me spam contacts. I'm sorry if I'm going on a rant, people. It's just that irritates the hell out of me. Microsoft has not stepped into the 21st century yet. Get it together. All right. Anyway, of course, what ends up happening here is Bizarro kind of draws the ire of one of the guys by, you know, a sandwich wrapper gets hit on the dude, you know, and of course, Bizarro kind of freaks out and kills the guy. And Trickster's response is, no, you can't do that, because now we have witnesses. You know, there are all these witnesses around who saw what we were doing, you know, and when Bizarro asks about witnesses, you know, Trickster says, no, yeah, witnesses are bad. You know, they cause problems for us. Bizarro says, okay, well, no more witnesses. And he kills them all. Now, again, this is Bizarro not really being able to grasp the basis of the situation. You know, his intelligence just isn't really quite there. He's able to grab little bits and pieces of things, but he can't put things together in a thought-out strung of sentences. It's just not how he works. It's just not how he functions. He just has a diminished capacity. Now, of course, racing off with Trickster, Trickster says, hey, man, look, you can't just kill people like that. And this is cool, because this is Trickster discovering his good side as he's dealing with Bizarro. Because by talking to Bizarro and telling Bizarro everything wrong that Superman's doing, Trickster's also discovering what it means to be a good guy. The problem with this is that Trickster had previously given Bizarro advice, saying, hey, man, you have to cover your mouth when you sneeze. Bizarro goes to sneeze, you know, uses both of his hands, drops Trickster. Trickster dies when he smashes onto the side of a mountain. That is the saddest thing ever. It's the saddest thing ever. And the reason why is because Bizarro races off to that guy that made his outfit and says, hey, fix him. And the guy's like, look, dude, I can't fix that guy. Like, he's dead, man. He's not a costume. He's not a suit. You can't fix him. Like, he's gone, man. Like, he's dead. Of course, Bizarro, not really getting the answers he seeks, ultimately races off to find Lex Luthor. It says, Lex Luthor, fix him. Now, again, this is Bizarro on his most primitive level. On some level, Bizarro knew that Lex Luthor, at the very least, was able to trace his roots back to Lex Luthor. It doesn't mean that Bizarro knew that Lex Luthor made him. It just means he was able to kind of go by his instincts and trace himself back to Lex Luthor. The problem is that Lex Luthor says, look, man, your friend's dead, dude. There's nothing we could do here. You know, not only that, Lex Luthor is basically learning that he was made by Bizarro. Bizarro. And this is when Bizarro starts to recall a couple things here and there. You know, you're the science man. You know, you made me, that kind of thing, where he's able to kind of piece together the little bits of information that he got from Trickster in terms of tracing back his origin and that kind of thing. Now, the problem with this is that Bizarro presents a very dangerous situation for Lex Luthor, because if Superman learns that Lex Luthor made Bizarro, Superman is going to come to the most logical conclusion and say, you made Bizarro to defeat me, you're working against me, and suddenly Lex Luthor gets a black bag thrown over his head and he's never seen or heard from again. And so because of this, Lex Luthor says, okay, fine, let's do a few experiments here and there. But the entire time he's basically guiding Bizarro in the direction that Lex Luthor has no idea who he is, that he doesn't know what he's about. He doesn't know, you know, where he came from. And so of course, performing temperatures, performing tests and things like that, Lex Luthor comes to the realization that Bizarro, of course, you know, his creation, pretending that he's not, that Bizarro is every bit the same as Superman with the exception of his intellect. And so what Lex Luthor does is he actually sends Bizarro over to the Fortress of Solitude. The problem with this is that Lex Luthor basically activates the brainwashing program that was designed for the purpose of turning villains into people that can be used by the regime. The first of which is Doomsday. And so when Bizarro arrives in the Fortress of Solitude, Doomsday doesn't differentiate between Superman and Bizarro. Doomsday just sees the outfit and attacks Bizarro. And so what this does is it leads to a pretty cool confrontation again. I mean, it leads to a pretty cool battle. Of course, Superman basically learning that there's a huge conflict going down in the Fortress of Solitude ends up, you know, showing up here and trying to figure out what's going on with Bizarro at the same time trying to fight Doomsday. Now, the whole time this is going on in the background, Lex Luthor is trying to find a way to eliminate Bizarro. Now, of course, he's told by Superman, do not let him get killed, do not let him die, incapacitate him, but do not kill him. He needs to be kept alive so we can figure out what's going on with him. The problem with this is that it's his dirty little secret. And so, of course, Lex Luthor does exactly what he thinks he should do, or exactly what he knows he should do, and he makes Doomsday kill Bizarro. And that's the saddest thing, is because when Bizarro's dying, like, he's simply just saying, like, he's dying like a child. He's like, oh, it hurts, you know? And he's just voicing himself in simplified words. Doomsday ends up killing him, and that's the end of Bizarro. He basically, you know, crushes a skull. And that's one of the saddest things, is because with Bizarro, that's why I loved him so much. With Bizarro, he was like this pure innocence in Injustice, right? I mean, he was basically a kid. You know, he was this purely innocent thing. Bizarro is a perfect example of people becoming what it is that they're made to be. It's this funny, bright light in a world of just dark people. And now Bizarro's dead. You know, symbolically, I would go as far as to say this just represents the dying of the light. This is basically the end. I mean, it's basically, you know, it's Brian Buccolito sitting down and saying, this is how far things have gone. This is how dark they are now. This is the direction that we're in. That things are basically falling to pieces. That there is no such thing as good guys or bad guys anymore. It's basically just bad guys. It's villains. People who walk this murky middle ground. And so, again, we basically pick up with the Flash Briana. What's happening is the Rogues, of course, are in Keystone City. And they're basically celebrating the lives of those individuals who were killed. Heatwave. I keep wanting to say Mickey Rourke. But, you know, Heatwave and so on and so forth. Trickster. That kind of thing. Barry Allen shows up. And immediately he's attacked by the other members of the Rogues, but he says, look, I'm here to pay my respects. You guys were bad guys, and we fought time and time again, but the one thing you guys never did is kill people. And I think on that, we can share common ground. On that, we can share the fact that I respected the guys who were here. I respected the fact that they never killed people. This small little thing, this little nugget, this tiny little instance, this one thing that they did in their lives is what allows common ground between, you know, Barry Allen and the Rogues, and they all end up sharing a beer together. And that's the greatest thing about this, is because what this is Injustice basically sitting down and saying, hey, look, in this situation, there's common ground to be had between good guys and bad guys, because everybody's lost someone. Everybody's lost someone they've cared about. And because of that, they are all very similar in terms of how they function. And so what we end up doing here is we transition over to Superman visiting Alfred. Now, Superman visiting Alfred is this incredible conversation. The reason why is because this is basically Alfred having no fear. Alfred would make an amazing Green Lantern. Just throwing it out there. Alfred has no fear. All right, Superman shows up. It's like, you know, according to Damian Wayne, you're saying that I'm crazy. You're saying that I'm insane. And Alfred's like, yeah, basically, that's exactly what I said. You're the Man of Steel. Bullets bounce off of you. No one on Earth can hurt you. You have incredible powers. You can fly from one side of the universe to the other. You have incredible abilities. But in the end, you're just a coward. You're a coward and a fool. You're a man who's allowed fear to rule his life. That's all you are. Nothing more than a wimp. You're just a crying little boy begging for someone to help you. It's an absolute insult to Superman, not just in terms of everything he's fought for as a superhero, but in terms of his manhood. But in truth, Alfred's right. Superman is a coward. Superman's hiding behind the mask of truth and justice. He's hiding behind his desire to make the world a better place, all for no other reason than the fact that he was tricked by a villain into doing a really bad thing, and he can't get past it. Superman is, by definition, a coward. Instead of facing his fears, instead of facing the fact of the situation, instead of facing things for what they are, he would rather just cower and hide. He would rather just try to be something that he's not. And so what this does is this kind of transitions, you know, a little bit of a tail end here with regards to Batman meeting up with Hawkman. And this is where we find out Hawkman didn't just go. Hawkman didn't just leave. He's not just out of the picture. Hawkman still has a vendetta, more so than he did before, because in his mind, his wife, Hawkgirl, has been taken from him. She's been brainwashed, duped, manipulated, whatever you want to call it, by the regime. And the result is that Hawkman feels like his honor's been disrespected, that his legacy's been disrespected. He has a grudge against Superman and the regime. And what this does is it gives Batman a powerful ally. It gives Batman a very powerful ally. Batman's intelligence mingled with Hawkman's skill makes him someone formidable. And so because of this, you know, as we wrap this video up, we pick up here with one of the saddest moments of injustice. One of the saddest moments of injustice. We start out with Sinestro, Superman meeting with Sinestro. Right. And they're talking about a plan releasing someone at the request of Superman. When Sinestro says, look, once you've achieved your goal, where am I going to find you? Superman says, you won't find me, I'll find you. They're keeping things very hush-hush. We switch back over to Batman, you know, talking with Alfred. And Batman's basically celebrating Alfred's birthday. The problem is it doesn't seem like it's Alfred's birthday. And one of the funny things is that Alfred has never told Batman how old he is. We also have Alfred, you know, saying that Kate had called, you know, that Barbara had called, that all the members of the Bat family are wishing their, you know, wishing happy birthdays to Alfred. We don't know if this is actually his birthday or not, but Batman's like, this is Alfred's birthday. Batman, you know, Alfred won't tell me when his birthday is, so this is his birthday. It's going to be on this day, whether it's true or not. But at the same time, this is why I say the relationship between Alfred and Bruce Wayne is father and son, because Alfred can read him like a book. Alfred said, what's wrong? That you wouldn't just call me up out of the blue. What's wrong with you? And Batman's response is, maybe I am being stubborn. Maybe I am just being ridiculous. Maybe I just cannot let my ego go. Maybe I just cannot accept the fact that Superman's made the world a better place. Alfred's response is no. Superman has become a murderer. Superman has made the world a worse place. Sure, maybe it's safer, but safer at what cost? People are not able to walk the streets without looking over their shoulders. People just kind of feel like things are a little bit darker, things are a little bit less safe than they used to be. And that small feeling changes everything. And so in Alfred's mind, the world is a worse place than what it is. People should be able to walk down the street without fear of being rounded up and tossed in camps. But because of the fact that they have that fear, the world is just a little less safe. And it's not just the United States, it's the world, because it's Superman. No matter where people go, they will never be safe. And so as the two of them kind of say their goodbyes, you know, kind of say, you know, the good nights and so on and so forth, there's an intruder in Batcave. Of course, Alfred responds, and this intruder turns out to be Victor Zsasz. Of course, a guy who's more or less crazy, you know, creates scars on himself every time he kills somebody, but he basically ends up going against Alfred. Of course, Victor Zsasz kind of comments on the nature of the Batcave, so on and so forth. You know, Alfred says, well, if you're looking for Batman, he's not here. Victor Zsasz says, no, I'm looking for you, and I was sent by the devil himself. Victor Zsasz slashes Alfred, guts him, leaves him for dead, and that's it. Damian Wayne comes downstairs, and this is why it's so sad. Damian Wayne, the one guy who just cannot see eye to eye with Bruce Wayne, the one guy who just seems dark and broody and angry at the world, comes down the stairs of the Batcave singing happy birthday to you for Alfred, only to discover that Alfred has been killed. With that being said, guys, we're gonna bring this video to an end, and God, this is the saddest moment in all of Injustice. God, it's so sad. Like, it's heartbreaking. It's so heartbreaking. Alfred's been killed. But I'm gonna tell you this much, man. I'm gonna tell you this much. Superman wanted to call down the thunder. Well, now he's got it. Like, he's prodded the beast, man. He has, Damian Wayne's coming, my friend. And hell is coming with him. But if you are new here to Comics Explained, make sure you guys hit the sub button to become part of the Rob Corps. If you guys enjoyed this video, make sure you drop a like, and I will catch you guys later. Peace.